Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Welcome to a new series of under 9 minutes in which I will give you Allah as He described Himself in the Qur'an. What you know about Allah is general knowledge. It's really not as precise as Allah wants you to do. By that I mean your knowing of Allah is mixed up with what the hadith says, with what the sayings of the scholars say, how they described Allah and everything. Yet, none ever brought Allah to you as He introduced Himself in the Qur'an. You see, Allah did so many different things to manifest Himself. And again, because of that ignorance or because of that human influence in how Allah is, we get people today that tell you, why does Allah use the masculine pronoun he? Why doesn't He use she? And then there are some people that took it to the next level of stupidity and they started saying the mother God, or she did this and she did that. And mostly these are the feminists that do that. So why did humanity reach this kind of level of baseness? Why? Well, the He, as it turns out to be, is not a definitive pronoun. That means Allah is not masculine and Allah is not feminine. And I will say one day, and I will explain one day as to why we use the pronoun He. Also, when Allah spoke about Himself, His emotions, how He sees the world, what He had in His intentions when He created, how we humans turned out to be, and how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at some point did this or did that, and why He did this and why He did that. You see, so many of us today, or so many of the believers today, they listen to the Quran and they go to Taraweeh in Ramadan, and some of them they play it on the radio in the car, and just thinking by the mere having the Quran playing in the car, they're not going to have any road collisions or any accidents or something like that. And others put the Quran in their car so that they bring blessings, so that nobody steals their car and so on and so forth. But the truth of the matter is, what makes people act the way they do? Well, it is mostly and predominantly their lack of knowledge about Allah. They don't know what Allah is. They have a vague idea. Let me give you an example. Have you ever been to Hawaii? Well, the likelihood of you going there is really grim. And if you say yes, I would say, have you been to Maui? And it's an island in Hawaii Islands. The likelihood of you going there is actually more grimmer than grim. Then if you say yes, then I'm going to say, have you been to the Haleakala Mountain? And then you're going to say, what's that? And then there you go. I found a spot that you haven't been to. Well, here is the same thing. If I ask you about Allah, tell me what Allah, and I'm going to say this. Don't tell me He is the creator of everything. Do not tell me that He created the heavens and earth in 6 days. Do not say that He is the Lord of the judgment day. Do not tell me anything about His creation. Tell me something about Allah Himself, not what He does. A lot of people today, they know Allah by what He does, but not who He is. To bring this home, I will say this. If you are a doctor, a GP, a general practitioner, a medical doctor, right? That's what you do. That's not who you are. And you will find doctors who tell people about good health and they themselves smoke. Hey, there you go. So you've got like the two contradictions in one human. So who is Allah as Himself, not what He does. One day, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did something that absolutely will break your mind. It's impossible. He invited a human being to introduce Himself to that human being, and through that introduce Himself, i.e. Allah, to us mere mortals. That human representative is Musa alayhi assalam, Musa, the prophet or the messenger of the children of Israel. That man. Well, here is the story a little bit. Okay, Musa was lost in the desert. Allah caused the winds to blow. Allah caused Musa to lose direction. Then Allah, out of good planning, What he did, he lit some kind of a fire, because it was not really a real fire, the burning fire. It was far more an indicative of light. So from afar, you would think it is a fire. But when you get closer, it is a light that emanates from a tree in a valley that Allah later on called Tuwa. And I will tell you why Allah called it Tuwa. Long story short, and I will deal this later on, when Musa alayhi salam gets there and he is right in there in the presence of the divine, of Allah himself, but in only one way, speech. Allah spoke to Musa, but Allah did not manifest himself as in CI vision to Musa alayhi salam. Later on, Musa asked for this favor, but and I will explain this again in its due time. Musa arrives to the place where he saw the lights from, and it's a big valley, it's a huge valley. Allah names the valley Tuwa. And the first command that Allah gave to Musa alayhi salam was, اخلعن عليك, remove your shoes, remove whatever you are wearing at your feet at that time. When you look at the scholars and the books of tafsir and everything, they say that because Musa was wearing a pair of shoes made of a pig leather, so that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told him to remove that, and that they attribute these sayings to some of the companions. And absolutely this is a lie, because Musa alayhi salam was a follower of the religion of Yaqub alayhi salam, and in their religion eating pork has always been haram, so it's impossible for Musa alayhi salam to do that. And these are conjectures, these are lies of scholars to give meaning to anything they didn't know. But the reason why Allah told Musa to remove his shoes is like if someone comes to you to learn, say, martial arts or painting, or they want to learn from you anything, the first thing you want to tell them is empty your cup. Empty your cup. You understand exactly what I said. Empty your cup meaning stop, don't bring past knowledge to this table, because something new is gonna start. And that is exactly what it meant. Remove your shoes as equals to empty your cup. Musa understood. So in this series, I will speak about Allah. I will present you, I will give you Allah as he says in the Quran, because we need to really know who Allah is from his own words, from the mouth of the Quran, so that we actually establish a good connection with Allah. The Allah that we know today is not the Allah that wants to be known. Even in our salat, we talk to some third party. Allahu Akbar, Allah is great. It's like you talk to somebody, and instead of saying you eat, you tell them does XYZ eat, and you are referring to their name. It doesn't make sense. So what has gone wrong in our history about Allah? Why is Allah a third party in our life that we don't express any emotions towards? We don't have a good connectionship with Allah. This is what I will be, idhnillah, explain in this series, to connect you really truly with Allah, so that we can have a good relationship with him here and also enjoy the next life with him there. Because take it, if Allah says something in the Quran, that's what Allah wants. No hadith, no sayings of the scholars. And in this series, I will bring evidences as how the hadith and the scholars distorted the image of Allah in our lives. And until our next talk, please stay in the mercy of Allah. And I'll see you again with the next installment about I Give You Allah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.